Further discussion on WPW syndrome, a follow-on video for WPW syndrome basics covering concertina effect and structural heart diseases associated with WPW syndrome. Progressive decrease in PR interval with reciprocal increase in QRS width due to changing degree of pre-excitation has been termed concertina effect in WPW syndrome. It may be noted that the PJ interval from the beginning of P wave to the end of the QRS remains constant. It has been mentioned that those manifesting concertina effect is likely to have higher accessory pathway refractory period. This would translate to lower ventricular rates in case of occurrence of atrial fibrillation and hence lesser chance of sudden cardiac death. WPW syndrome with atrial fibrillation is a potentially life-threatening situation because of the very fast ventricular rates, which can lead on to ventricular fibrillation. Atrial fibrillation with fast ventricular rate is encountered in accessory pathways with short refractory periods, typically less than 250 milliseconds. Concertina effect has been described during an episode of vasospastic angina in a person with WPW syndrome. In this case, a gradual prolongation of AH interval was documented in the His bundle electrogram. Epstein's anomaly, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and mitral wall prolapse are the important structural heart diseases associated with WPW syndrome. Developmental anomaly of the tricuspid valve is associated with delayed intra-atrial conduction, right bundle branch block, and accessory atrioventricular pathways in Epstein's anomaly. In a series of 224 patients, 64 had documented tachycardia. 33 with recurrent tachycardia had a single right-sided accessory pathway which was successfully ablated. Only 21 of the 33 had typical ECG pattern of pre-excitation. An interesting finding was that none had an ECG pattern of right bundle branch block during sinus rhythm. Radio frequency catheter ablation resulted in the appearance of RBBB in 94% of the patients. Absence of RBBB in patients with Epstein's anomaly with recurrent tachycardia had 98% sensitivity and 92% specificity for the diagnosis of an accessory pathway. An interesting case of hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, sinus tachycardia, and pulmonary edema has been reported. Coronary angiogram was normal and she was discharged on metoprolol after recovery. 1 month later, she presented with atrioventricular tachycardia and underwent accessory pathway ablation. Still another 2 weeks later, she presented with ventricular tachycardia and was given an implantable cardioverter defibrillator. She had all typical complications of hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, which were promptly and successfully treated. Please don't forget to subscribe to this channel for future updates and click on the bell icon for all updates. Thank you.